Svarev, Naivare Amandare. So the first example where we don't see oscillations are elliptic problems, right? So iconic example of the so-called elliptic problem. Why elliptic? Because if you write down, this is a linear equation, Laplace of U is equal to F on a bounded domain with Dirichlet boundary conditions. So that's something what is being taught, at least in Prague, in a basic course. To my taste, too much. Students know a lot of things about this problem, but they know much less about OLM, right? Because we have a large group of people working in that. So the potential theory, why elliptic, you know that, because if I take like Fourier transform of this problem, so Laplace and Fourier transform gives you, so if xi is a Fourier variable, this will transform to xi is equal times the Fourier transform of the unknown function is equal to Fourier transform of it. So this is like this is like something which gives you in general an equation for the ellipse. And so you can see that now dividing by this xi square, you get actually a unique solution which has derivatives actually. So this is a problem where you don't see oscillations, which means if I have a set, so assume we now know this is very naive, this is a linear problem, right? So we know from some theory of elliptic equation there is a unique solution of this problem in some Sobolev space, but this simple equation does not allow solutions to oscillate. Why? Because so we have certain what is called a priori bounds. So if I have a solution of this problem, suppose that what I mean we do not have oscillations means that I cannot construct or I cannot see solutions like that. Of course, this is not a proof. I'm just assuming that I have a solution, but assume that I have a solution, then I multiply the equation by u and I do integration by parts, right? So Laplacian of u gives me minus Laplacian of u times u, since u is zero on the boundary, gives me gradient of u squared. Again, don't hesitate to ask me if I'm using some symbols which are so familiar. And so this is the gradient of u square, and if I multiply, and this should be equal to f cross u. And now I use Euler inequality. So this is less or equal. So the right-hand side is now less or equal the norm of f in the space L2, in the space of integrable functions, and norm of u in L2. And finally, I use something what is called Poincaré inequality, which means that there is a certain constant here, so that the L2 norm can be estimated by the gradient of u. This is because of this boundary condition. Normally, this is impossible, we know, because if I take a constant function, this will be zero. So finally, the right-hand side will be less or equal than some constant times f. F is a given function and time gradient of u in L2, and what I have on the left-hand side is a gradient of u in L2 squared. So I can divide by that, and I get this, which tells me that each time, whenever I have a solution of this problem, its gradient must be bounded in the L2 space. So the solution must be such that its gradient must be bounded. Now I am assuming that everything is smooth, but I can do this in the sense of generalized derivatives as well, that's the theory of weak solutions. But let's assume that everything is smooth. Whenever I have a solution, then the gradient must be bounded in L2. So there is something what is called the Relic-Kondrashev theorem. So gradient bounded in L2 means that solution belongs to the Sobolev space, which is sometimes denoted W12, which is the space of functions which are in L2, and the gradient of them is also in L2. And so the gradient, so you can feel it, if I have a derivative which is bounded, then the solution can oscillate. So in particular, this space is compactly embedded. If this is a bounded domain, this is compactly embedded in the space of integrable functions or L2. And so if I have a sequence which is bounded in this space, then it is compact in L2. So if I have un, such that W12 is bounded by some constant, then this implies that there is a subsequence such that UNK converges to U in the space L2. So in particular, this implies, again, for a subsequence convergence almost everywhere. So this is a pointwise convergence, and so the solution cannot oscillate, because if it converges pointwise, it's not oscillatory. I have no problem. So So you see that the fact that the U satisfies certain differential equations implies compactness, right? So the set of solutions, of all possible solutions of this very simple problem, is compact. And this is not going to be the case for Euler. We will see that solutions for Euler that will satisfy Euler will not have this property. Right? This is what is behind this new method. Okay, there will be, so this is a trivial classical example, but you may say, but that's a cheating thing, because you are cheating now, because this is an elliptic equation, there is no time. Euler, that I showed you, was time dependent, so let's do something more, something less trivial. Next slide. Let's do scalar conservation law. So this is the following equation. This is an iconic example of a nonlinear equation where you can see all already at this very simple, for this very simple problem, you can see some very unpleasant phenomena. So sometimes this is called transport equation. Let me explain the meaning of this equation. So you may think the simplest. Okay, so I'm sorry, I'm using the name Berger's. Maybe for some people, Berger's equation means that there is also viscosity. For some people, Berger's means the following equation. So this is the equation d by dt, the partial derivative of u, plus u dx of u is equal to 0, which means this I can write as 1/2 of dx of u squared. So it's like this problem where f of u is equal to 1/2 of u squared. Right? And so for this problem, so now the question is, can we have do we have compactness for this equation? I mean, if I know that I have solutions of this problem, un, can I say that the fact that they satisfy this equation will mean that, for instance, if I have un, un satisfy the problem, can I say that un converges strongly, maybe almost everywhere, some u? Or can I say that the gradient of u is bounded, for instance? Well, strangely enough, on this problem, of course, we cannot say that the gradient is bounded. I will show you an example. But we still have compactness. At least, strangely enough, compactness here is imposed by the fact that this function here is nonlinear. So what is the physics? I mean, that's a very simple example of, if I write it in this way, this is a very simple example of what is called a transport equation. And so so the model is like, it's a very naive model. So you have a road. And now you have, so this one-dimensional road, which is already kind of, but maybe some narrow streets in India could be a good approximation. And then you have cars. Cars are sitting here, so I have now, I have a continuum of cars. It's a kind of model. And each car has some velocity. So for each x, so uxt is the velocity of a car at the position x and time t. So this u means 1D velocity because the cars are moving either right or left, so the velocity is now only, it's not a vector, it's just scalar function. And so u, which is not this, and so the interpretation of this equation is that each car, so you start at the initial time t, you give me some distribution of the velocities, like, I mean, each car wants to go, has the intention to go with some velocity, and now they start moving. And each car wants to keep its own velocity forever. And this is described by this equation. So which means that if I start here with this velocity, I will keep it forever, so I will move like that. If this is velocity is higher, I will move like that. If this is lower, I move like that. I will move like that. And this is this simple equation. This equation can be used as models for other phenomena, but that's one of the simplest interpretations. So you can immediately see that there is something wrong, right? Why? Because if you have cars like that, this is not possible to keep forever. And I will show you on the next slide that indeed. So, for instance, if this car is slow and this car is fast, after some time, they will collide. And so there will be some problem. The motion will not be smooth, and this is indeed what happens for this equation. And so it's not very surprising that, and this is very simple, and this is because of the equation is non-linear. For instance, if I take a linear equation, which I think I can, but okay, I'm going to the next slide, but then I go back to the first slide. I don't think it's, if it's convenient, but I would like to go. No, this is not important to go. Okay, so let's take it. So for instance, if you take this equation, when this u replaced by constant, so you would get something like that. Ut of u plus dx of u is equal to zero, for instance. This is an equation. So now you can see if I take u of dx, which is a given function, which is some given function u. So if I take this, it's clear, well, if this is, for instance, let's start with the C1 function. So it's clear if I take the derivative of this function with respect to t, I get u bar of t minus x. If I take the derivative respect to x, I get minus u bar of t minus x. Right? And this is obviously zero. So any function of this form is a solution of this problem. And because it's linear problem, I don't have this function here. So these are like cars that all of them are moving with the same speed. So what happens is that, well, if I draw, so these are functions which are constant on the lines. This is t minus x is equal to constant, right? So these will be cars that will be moving. So you start like that, and all of them will be moving this velocity one. And so for this problem, you don't see any collisions like that. But you can also see that for this problem, solutions may develop oscillations, right? Because now this u, I can take un, which will be something like sinus, so un of z. Will be this my favorite example of sinus n of z. Now this will propagate, right? So we already know that this is a sequence that develop oscillations, but according to these equations, these oscillations will only propagate like that. So at any time I will see this oscillation. So this equation cannot prevent oscillations, although it's a very simple linear equation. This constraint is not enough. I mean, the solution, roughly speaking, this, if you want, this is just a derivative with respect to some direction which should be zero. So the function should be constant in certain directions, which is exactly this direction. And it can do whatever in the perpendicular direction. In particular, it can oscillate. So we can have oscillations. You say, bad problem. But still, it's not why they should be bad. Now, if I start, but these are oscillations which are imposed to the solutions only through the data. If I do not, it is clear that if I take data that oscillate, that maybe the solutions will oscillate. But if I don't take this, if I take something which is nice, then solution of this problem will be nice and you will not see oscillation. So this equation also prevents oscillations in the sense that if you take nice data, you will not see oscillation. But it's a linear equation. This nonlinear equation, so the question is, do we have the same properties for the nonlinear equation or is it somehow more complicated? So you would expect something like similar to that. And actually, we will see that for the nonlinear equation, it's even better. In the sense that even if the initial data oscillate, the solution, I mean, the nonlinearity will prevent oscillation. The fact that these cars can collide will somehow prevent oscillation for later times. So this equation for a nonlinear function behaves even in a better way than the linear equation. But you must have like something what is called a genuinely nonlinear function, something, for instance, what is convex, right? Convex function should not be linear somewhere, because if it's linear, you would automatically get what is written there. But if you have a nonlinear function like this, then we will see that actually there is, the oscillations are impossible. Solutions of this problem will be compact, in the sense that if I have a sequence of solutions of this problem, and I will have, for instance, bounded initial data, then the solution will be bounded and will be compact, will converge almost everywhere in space-time. So this is a very simple example. And if you think about Euler, this is exactly the nonlinearity we see in Euler. So you would somehow feel that Euler should be good, but this is 1D problem, and this is not 1D. In 1D, there is no. So let's discuss this equation. So the first observation is, maybe I should show you first why this equation can develop singularities. Let's start with a simple observation. There is something what is called entropies for this equation. Entropies are certain quantities, you remember for the Euler system we had energy. It was something like extra quantity we computed from the equations, and we had some equation for the energy. So here there is something similar. So imagine, you take a function S. So I will formally assume that I have solutions for this problem, which are, say, smooth, and I will assume they are smooth. At the end of the day, we will see that it's impossible to have smooth solutions. However, everything what I have been talking about will apply also to what is called weak solutions. But let's start with solutions that are smooth. Then I can take a function S, which is, assume that S is a differentiable function. And I multiply the equation by the derivative S prime. S prime is a derivative which exists. So I take S prime of U, I assume that I have solution, and multiply the equation by that. So what I obtain is that there is S prime of U times dt of U. But as we know, that this is dt of S of U. So I get S prime of U dt of U plus S prime of U dx of F of U is equal to 0. So now you know that I can write that dt of F of S of U. Now about this there, I'm in one space dimension, so I can formally, I assume that everything is small, so I can formally write this as F prime of U dx of U. Now, this is some function of one real variable, so I can integrate, I can find a primitive which I denote by F. I find a function such that F prime is equal to this, which is just the integral from 0 to U of this quantity. And so this one will be F prime dx of U, so I will get finite. So this is dx of F of U, that is equal to 0. So I have this equation. And you may say, so this is some extra information. You may say, this is nothing new, because you have just used the first equation and you multiply by something. It's nothing new, provided you have strong solutions, provided you can do that. It's the same as the energy for Euler. It's exactly the same phenomenon. If you have smooth solution for Euler, you can compute the energy, and you know the energy satisfies some equation. Here, I could do it, but I can do it only under the assumption that I have smooth solution. If I consider weak solutions, this is in general not true, and I have to take this as an extra condition. But this is an information you can use, for instance, in the estimates, because this is available, for instance, if you solve this equation by some approximations. So this is sometimes called entropy equality. Sometimes in the literature, this is replaced by the entropy inequality, which is the same thing with inequality, and in addition, you assume that this function S is convex. So this is something less. So you say that you have entropy solutions, and this is also used for the weak solutions later. If you have this equation plus this inequality for any convex function S and any F, F is sometimes called entropy flux. So these two things, if you have them, you speak about entropy solutions. And it's something like energy inequality for Euler. Let me explain why convex and why inequality, right? So why one somehow assumes that, why not concave and the opposite inequality, whatever. Of course, you can assume everything. It's up to you. And this is what I repeat when I talk to students. This assumption is motivated by the fact that you are thinking about fluids. Finally, So in particular, we impose something what's called second law of thermodynamics, which means that the system itself is somehow tending to increase the entropy. And so, for instance, if you talk about cars, like that was my first motivation, showing you these cars, it might not be that this is a good condition. Why? Because the drivers, they do not behave as molecules of a gas. Roughly speaking, you do not want to destroy your car because of the second law of thermodynamics, right? You want to use your brakes, and this would maybe give you another condition. So this condition is always motivated by the context. But so let me show you why this. Well, this comes from the viscous approximation. So, okay, so you may say, well, this is a nonlinear equation. It's difficult to solve. So let's try to solve something that's simpler. What is simple, although the equation looks more complicated, is this one. I take epsilon, which is a small parameter, and I put Laplace in here. So this is, again, in analogy with Euler, this is like replacing Euler by Navier-Stokes. This is called artificial viscosity. Maybe not artificial, maybe there is some viscosity. So if you think about it as a kind of, so in particular if you have this, it's almost like Euler, right? But here we are in one space dimension, so if I impose the condition that divergence of u is zero, I would get constant, it's not very exciting. So it's not Euler, no? It's more like compressible Euler, but we will speak about it later. So I, instead of solving the original problem, I put this extra term here, which represents viscosity. Now this is like a parabolic equation. So you know that, for instance, if this term is not here, this is what is called heat equation, right? Again, an example of equation that is being taught in the basic course. And we know this equation has very nice properties, has smooth solutions. Even for bad initial data, it has very nice solutions. So this equation which describes propagation of heat. So even if you start with data, with jumps, without this term, the equation will immediately be smooth. I mean, solutions will be smooth. And so, in particular, if you add this term to the equation, it's a lower order term, right? Because this is like second order operator, that's Laplacian operator in X. This is first order operator. So you somehow suppose that if epsilon is a positive parameter, you can have solutions of this problem. And this is indeed the case. You can show there exist solutions. And they are nice. They are smooth. So at this level, I have smooth solutions. And now I would expect that somehow solutions of this system should be obtained as the limit when epsilon goes to zero. And so let me now do this argument. Well, I am saying Laplacian. Actually, we are in one space dimension, so Laplacian is simply two derivatives with respect to x. Okay. So now, if I perform the limit, I would somehow expect that properties of this equation, which are sort of preserved by this limit, should be true also for this equation. So let's do this entropy equation. So I do the same trick as before. I multiply by S prime of u. So I get dt of S of u plus this dx of F of u. This is the same. But on the right-hand side, I get what? I have epsilon, two derivatives of u. So times F of u, so this I can write as epsilon dx of u, f u, sorry, this is S prime of u. So I can write this as the derivative of S prime of u, right? It's almost like that, but I have to subtract minus two derivatives of S dxu squared dx of u x is. Yeah. So we have this. I mean, there is epsilon here. Now you want to pass to the limit. So you want to take epsilon. So you have solutions which you write like epsilon.
So this you mix epsilon.
And now you would like to, so assume that you can show by some chance that, well, everything is bounded. You would like to say that, well, the limit of this is a big solution of the problem. So what you would do is that you would transfer all derivatives on the test function. And so you can do it here. You can do it here. You can also do it here because you can put one derivative on the test function. But you cannot do it here because you have used x squared. But this term, since if f is convex, the two derivatives are non-negative. Right? So, and this is a non-negative. This is a positive term. So non-negative. This is a positive term. So the whole thing is non-negative. But since there is a minus, it's negative. And so in the limit, this term will produce this inequality. So that's the reason. So in the limit, you somehow, you would say, I don't see this term, but if you don't see this term, this would require that epsilon times dx of u square is a bounded function in the limit, and it somehow is not. I don't explain why, but this is the motivation why you see inequality, and for that you need convex function. If f was not convex, we would not have this positive, and we would be lost, right? And so this is motivation for this condition, that sometimes this condition, which looks like a more restrictive, is replaced by that. And this should hold for all solutions that are obtained in this viscous limit approximation. So for instance, for Euler, it's like that for the limit, you should expect to have energy inequality. This is why I said that energy inequality is still acceptable for Euler, not the opposite sign. So this comes from the fact that you somehow assume that this problem is approximation, or it's a limit of this problem when epsilon goes to zero. And so this is artificial viscosity. So if you somehow, and this you it must be given to you by the problem, right? If you do fluid mechanics, you assume that artificial viscosity is a good approximation because you assume that the fluid is somehow viscous. If you do something else, maybe artificial viscosity is not a good approximation. Maybe you should add something else, and you would get something else as condition. Okay, so we have now this, and now this inequality has several consequences, right? For instance, there is something like maximum principle for this problem, which tells you the following. The minimum principle, but it can be done from both sides. Huh? So I should call it minimum principle. Which means the following. So assume that I have this problem and I solve it for some initial data. So I assume that u at the time 0 mx is equal to u 0 x. And assume, for instance, that this is greater than, assume that it's greater than zero, but it can be taken any constant. Okay, and so now the claim is that I have this property. Okay, well, let's take whatever. I claim that this implies that if I have a solution of this problem, which satisfies this inequality, then I should also take something like boundary conditions. So I explain later. I claim that this implies that actually u at the time t and x, you have the same property for all positive t. Right? So this is called minimum principle. So if I start with the initial data which are greater than some constant, then the solution itself will be greater than this constant for any other time. It's like for the heat. You can do the same for from above. Okay, so I should somehow supplement this problem by some boundary condition. So I will, for instance, assume that I can assume something like that u at t0 is equal to u at t1, which is sometimes called periodic boundary conditions. Right? I assume that u is actually a periodic function with periodic one, with period one in space. do it. So I take my convex function, which is this. So I take, okay, there is some error. Okay, so it's not good. It's not consistent with my notation. There should be L here. There should be L. And actually, I am showing this. Okay, so I take a convex function which looks like that. So it's a function which is, okay, so this is my L, right? And the function is 0 up to L. And then it's positive. So it's clear that I can find the convex function like that. And now if I plug it in this inequality, I get what? I get f by dt of this function s plus dx plus the corresponding flux, which I have to compute from this formula, is less or equal than 0. And so I take the integral over from, I'm on the interval 0, 1. And now, since I have these periodic boundary conditions, sorry, there should be u. I integrate from 0, 1. Since I have the periodic boundary conditions, this is dx. If I integrate, I get the value at 1 minus the value at 0, but this is 0. Because I assume this, right, this is periodic, so I don't see this term there. So this term will disappear. And I get that, this integral, the derivative is like the energy in Euler. I get the energy, or you may call it energy. I get the time derivative of this integral is less or equal than 0. So in particular, it is a non-increasing function. Right? But now S itself is function which is greater than 0. So we assume now that initially, my initial datum, u0x, is less than L. So this is actually the case number 2, what I'm drawing. Then this means that this function initially is equal to 0. Right? So if I integrate this with respect to time, I get that the value of this function at the time t, dx, is less or equal than the same integral at the time 0. If I take this, if I assume that u is less than L, then this integral is equal to 0 because I'm here, so this I get 0. Right, so this is non-negative and it's less than 0, so it must be 0. And so this implies that actually the function S at u itself must be below L for almost any x, but if I assume that it's continuous, so it's for any s. Because if it was greater, I would get something positive. This would be positive, and this is impossible. So, using this very simple principle or a very simple entropy inequality, which can be sort of derived, I have the maximum principle. Because try to prove it directly, it's not like, if you try to repeat the proof of maximum principle for parabolic equations, maybe it's not so straightforward, but using the entropy. So, it particularly tells me the following. If I have the entropy solutions, which means solutions that do satisfy this inequality, then I have the maximum principle. So I know that if u0 is bounded in the absolute value by some constant L, this implies that the solution itself, dx, would be bounded by the same constant L. I mean, if you want the bound from below, instead of taking, so before we had a function which looked like that, so now I take a function which looks like this. This is again a convex function, and I can apply the same. Okay, so this is the first information. So it tells me that if I start with the initial data is something what I can prescribe. If I start with something which is bounded, I will have always a solution which is bounded by the same constant. So in particular, this implies there is no concentration. This problem, although this is a nonlinear function there, but I cannot have, well, okay, I didn't say, but for smooth solutions, we have seen there is no concentration. It's impossible to have blow up, which is called global.
Excuse me?
Yes.
We have a question here.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
application, you told the maximum principal if U stays above L, it always stays above L.
Yes.
So there you are assuming that the solution is smooth or it can also develop.
Here I am assuming formally that the solution is smooth, but it holds also for weak solution that will satisfy this energy inequality.
When you have shock, then the solution is diminishing, right? So it can.
But it is still bounded.
Yeah, bounded, but it cannot stay above L, right?
No, it cannot be smooth.
It will be greater than or equal to L. You know, the shock will start eating up the.
No. No. The shock will remain between these two values. The shock cannot get you out of the initial value.
Yeah, I agree, but. You are saying that if U naught is greater than L,
then the solution will be always greater than L.
Is less than, I agree. But how will you prove greater than? Because once your shock appears, say for instance, you take Butler's equation, one in an interval and zero outside. You know, as it goes on, once shock appears, the solution starts diminishing. So even if you say L equal to half, you take.
Yeah. But I am still below L.
Then the solution will go below half.
The solution will still satisfy them. It will diminish, but there is no contradiction.
What you wrote is correct. In the notes, what you wrote is fine. But when you say if U naught is greater than L,
I did not say that.
Not greater than L, that is something which is less than is fine.
If this is minus L and L, if U 0 is here, then the shock will always remain between these two values.
Yeah, I agree with that. But what was written previously was, if mod U naught is greater than L.
Yes, okay.
Mod U for all time stays above L, that is greater than L.
That's true.
That I could not understand.
Why? The shock will do, okay, so this is L. Let's call L minus L, it doesn't matter.
May I request you to write, you wrote in the previous one, mod U naught, if mod U naught is greater than L, then mod U is greater than L. You place mod U naught.
Yes,
L. Mod.
Yeah. Because if you start like that, so this is your L, right? So this is your U naught. Then you will get shock like that, but the shock will still continue between, will be still greater than L. Will not go below L. The shock will not go below L. The shock will not take the solution down.
Okay.
I mean, the amplitude of the solution will decrease, but there is no contradiction.
Yeah,
I still stay below L, right? Okay. So. No, this should not. Okay, so. But this means if I stay between minus L and L, then this is. Then the solution itself is staying between minus L and L. And I hope to go to shocks on the next line, but we're maybe not here later. But the shock will still have. The shock means that these cars I was speaking about, if you start with a situation which is something like that, this is your minus L, this is your plus L, after a while the solution will be discontinuous. And you have to interpret the solution in a different way because it's no longer smooth. And so there will be something like shock waves, which means that these guys will go to something, but they will still be between minus L and L. The shock doesn't let me down. It's impossible. Because it's the same for the viscous equation with a trinomial, and the shock is just, but okay, I do not want to anticipate. But I think what I'm saying is correct. Anyway, so I agree that formally this was a proof for smooth solutions, right? But we have this property. So there cannot be blow up. So sometimes there are nonlinear, this is a nonlinear equation. Sometimes there are equations for which the solution develops blow up. Which means that you start this nice data, but after a while the solution becomes infinite, like on my first example. So the claim is it is not possible here. Solution which starts with bounded data will always stay bounded I would say smooth solution, but later on we will see even weak solution that will satisfy this entropy inequality. Okay, and so let's go to compactness. Okay, so we are now we are in the case of blow. So next slide. So let me show you that this, assuming that actually solutions for this problem are that solutions for this problem are smooth for any time is not really a good assumption. So let me consider a trivial situation when we have this Poincaré's equation, which means that f of u is equal to u. So this is the model of these cars, right? Now you can show that actually, so I claim that if the solution is smooth, it means that if I have a car which starts with some velocity u0x here, right, then the car will move with the same velocity, which is given to u0x forever, right? So if I have the solution of this problem, it means that the solution at the time t, which means velocity of this car at the time t, so this is time, this is x. So the velocity of this car at the time t and the point x, so this is the point x, x plus t u0x, must be equal to the initial velocity u0x. This should be true for smooth solutions. Okay, if you don't believe me that this is a solution of the problem, you just take this and differentiate in time. So if I differentiate in time, I get what I get d by dt of u plus. Now I have the derivative of this with respect to x. So this is dx of u. And now I differentiate this with respect to, I have this equality, and I will show that, so this is a function of t and x, and this is a function of x only, and I show that this is a solution of my problem, right? So I differentiate this with respect to time. So I take the derivative of this respect to time of this function, and it should be the derivative with respect to time of this function. But this is a function which depends only on x, so there will be zero here. Now the derivative with respect to time, this is what? This is d by dt of u with respect to time for the first variable, plus derivative with respect to the second variable. Derivative of this with respect to time, which is u0. But u0 is u. Okay, so this is my equation. So solutions that are smooth must satisfy this, must comply with this formula. Okay, so if I use now, I consider the following, the situation which I was thinking about before, which is the bad one when there is a car which wants to go faster. I mean, there is a car behind another one, and the first one wants to go slower than the other one. So I have the situation when I have 2 points. So initially I have 2 points. U0 such that u0x1 is greater than u0x2, but x1 is less than x2, right? So I have two cars, so there is a point x1 and there is a point x2. And now the velocity here is bigger and the velocity here is smaller. So evidently what may happen is that, well, this will go like this. This will go slower and at a certain point meet. And at this point the solution might be the same, but it has two different values. And so this is exactly what is described here. Okay, so I know that u at the time t and at the point x1 plus t u0 at x1 is equal to u0x1, which is not x0, x2, u0, x2 is defined by that as the CCOT. So this is the value, this is the initial value, and that's the value of the solution at the point x2 plus t u0 x1. So now if I can choose t such that this point, which is the point x where I am, is the same as this one, then the solution at this point will have two different values, right? Because if this is equal to that, I have the value in the same point. So what it means? It means that I need x1 plus t, and this should be equal to that. But this is written down here. And from that you can compute t, I mean that's real. And you see, since x2 is greater than x1 and u0 x1 is greater than u0 x2, this is a positive quantity. And so there exists a positive time such that this happens. And if this happens, the solution apparently has two values. So what happens is the following. What happens is the following, that you so you will have so the value is, so this is the point which where you have the contact. So this is the point where x1 plus t u0 x1 is equal to x2 plus t u0 x2. So this is the point here. And so now on one hand we will have this value, which is this. And from the other side, we will need this value, which is smaller. So the solution will be smooth up to this moment. It will be like this. The car will start. And now, at this moment, it will happen that there will be discontinuity. Because the velocity from the left, so to speak, will be strictly greater than the velocity from the right. Okay. And so, this is what is called, what there was a remark, this is called shock wave, actually. But this is still not shock wave, because this is not the solution, that's just the state of the system. So now we have seen that no matter how smooth the initial data, so this you can imagine that you can do that for any choice of initial data. Each time when you have some situation when the velocity at some point x1, which is less than x2, is greater than this, then this must happen. Well, which is clear because the cars cannot undertake each other, and so there will be this collision or shock, and there will be collision of these two cars. But since we have continued, and so this may happen many times, and so this is independent of the fact that the solution is smooth initially, because basically any smooth data, the only situation when this doesn't happen is this one, right? If I take u0 x, which is an increasing function, but this is also clear from this, say, physical intuition, because these cars will go faster and these cars will go slower, there will be never collision. But each time there is one crazy guy who wants to go faster, there will be a collision. So this means that, unfortunately, I have smooth initial data. And I have, I can have even small, what means small? Small means that the velocity is almost zero. I can make, I mean, it's not really important that this was 200 kilometers per hour or 5. The only thing that matters is that there is a difference, that this is faster than this. So I can have also what is called small initial data. So for smooth and small initial data, there exists time, which sometimes is called maximal time, so that the solution cannot be smooth after the time. We actually did not prove that smooth solution exists, right? I didn't give you any proof that up to this time the smooth solution exists. However, you can expect, I mean, I didn't do any proof, but it can be proved that solution exists. But however, what we have seen and what is important is that no matter how smooth the data are, any smooth solution must develop. It's not blow up, it's called shock, because it's not like solution becomes infinite, but it becomes, there will be discontinuity. Cannot be continuous. And, well, this is the case for say any initial data, with the only exception of this one, so you can say that this is true for dense set of initial data, or for generics or whatever. Almost every initial data will give rise to this. And now if you think about Euler, we have similar nonlinearity in Euler. And so you would be tempted to say that this must definitely happen for Euler as well. But we don't know for incompressible Euler, the problem I had been discussing in the first part of my lecture. It is still not known if you have smooth initial data for which you would get shock. For compressible Euler, it is not. Compressible Euler in a way is much closer to the equation. Okay, so this means that actually one must be careful when you speak about solutions of this problem, because the argument is fine if the solution is smooth, but we know that it cannot be smooth. And so there are two possibilities how to get out of this dilemma. So the first thing is that you consider, the first possibility is that you forget the problem. And you say it's not good. I mean, since we are doing classical mechanics and solutions must be smooth, because there are derivatives and the derivatives exist. And now we have discontinuous solutions, so the derivatives do not exist. So can I interpret the derivatives in some way? No. So the first way would be, well, this is not a good problem. And so the answer would, so now what would be the way up? We still want to do physics. Okay, I agree that this is a very naive model, this motion of cars. But if you think about Euler, and for compressible Euler, we actually observe exactly the same thing. There is a shock appearing after a finite time. You may say, okay, it's not a good problem. So now the question is, so what? Physics doesn't give you a good problem, or no? The answer would be we neglected something in physics. And so we should replace it, take a good problem. Well, what would be a good problem for this equation? Well, a good problem for this equation, if you think about like some context in fluid mechanics, maybe not with cars, would be of course the viscous problem, right? So this was the problem. Well, I always write Laplacian, but actually it should be dxx squared of u, right? Is epsilon small? And, again, I did not prove anything, but this is a really good problem in the sense that this does not happen. I mean, there are no shocks for this problem. However, when epsilon is small, solutions of this problem will approach these shocks. And so you would say, okay, let's deal with this problem. Instead of, let's forget Euler, and let's do only Navier-Stokes. This would be the answer in fluid mechanics. We know that in fluid mechanics, Navier-Stokes is not much better. Here, definitely, we would have a better solution. And but then some engineers would say, but we can see these shocks, right? I mean, we observe a plane which is moving in the air. If it's like supersonic plane which exceeds the speed of sound, then somehow compressibility of the air comes into play, and they see this shock. I mean, you can hear it. Right? I mean, there are these supersonic planes that they produce some sharp sound at a certain moment. This corresponds to some kind of shock in the solution. So you would say, no, the shocks, they exist. But so the question is, maybe this equation, I mean, this formulation does not capture the shocks. So we can, so at the moment when we get, at the moment when we get this step there, we should take new solutions, a new concept of solutions, right? And so we will continue this as a weak solution. We will define something what is weak solution, which means the solution will not have derivatives, but will be solution of the problem. Okay, so how do you do weak solutions? So let me check what I have on the next slide. Because we didn't do that, right?
No, there are no weak solutions.
So let me show the definition of weak solutions now, because I keep speaking about weak solutions and never say what it is. Okay, so you remember when we were speaking, everything is related to this. I mean, the key word here is weak. So if we have like weak topologies, weak solution. So weak basically means that everything is replaced by averages. Use integral averages. So what this means is that instead of having derivatives, we take just integral average of the derivatives. We have seen already that the weak topology, actually, if you speak about weak convergence, you take its convergence in average. You take, instead of taking the function, you take an average on a small neighborhood, and you work with this leverage. And it somehow also corresponds to the idea, but I think now we are a little bit far away of having some molecules in the gas that finally, you know, what you see, like velocity of the gas, it's not really velocity because the gas is not like continuum, but it's an ensemble of many small particles, and what you see as a velocity is just some average of velocities. But it's not really correct approach because these are equations of fluid mechanics, of continuum fluid mechanics, so molecules are not, we are not going to do Boltzmann equation. So, but it could be that averages are in a way good. So how do you define weak solutions of this problem? Okay, so the usual way is that I write the equations. Okay, and I multiply them by test something which is called test function. I take phi, which is smooth. Smooth means that we will see how smooth we need. I mean, I sometimes hate it when people say smooth. You should say how smooth. Smooth means one derivative is enough. You can think about C infinity. But one derivative is enough. Actually, there is a non-trivial because I also want phi to have compact support. Support in the space. So assume that we have, we are on Rn, so I want the solution. So this phi should be zero except some compact set. It's an issue to construct C infinity function with compact support. Try to do that. I mean, that's an exercise we give to students in the first year. Because if you want compact support, somehow all derivatives on the left must be zero here. If the function must be C infinity, it cannot be analytic function. Right? You cannot write it as a Taylor series and so on. So C1 is better because C1 is easier. Okay, so what I do, I multiply formally. So how I do definition of weak solutions? I take my equation formally, I assume everything is fine. I multiply by phi. Again, I'm sorry if I do something what is well known. And I integrate over space to say Rn. Well, here we are in R1, because it's a scalar function. And I also integrate with respect to time. So maybe I integrate from 0 to t. And I want this compact support to be in, say, 0t times Rn. And I integrate this, so I do dx dt. And formally, this is going to be 0. And now I do integration by parts again. And since the functions have compact support, if I do, so I'm basically here, it's integration by parts. If it's a multi-d and there are divergence or other operators, is like Stokes' theorem. So which means that I put the derivatives on the test functions, and since the function has compact support, I don't see any boundary values of phi, so I put the derivative on the test function. So finally I get minus in front of everything, and I have u dt of phi plus f of u dx of phi dx dt. Should be equal to 0, but since minus is in front of everything, I can erase. And now I say this is a weak solution. So I say I have a weak solution. If this is true for any phi, say, so I need only one derivative, C1 with compact support in 0t times Rn. This is my definition. This is what I mean by weak solution. And now you observe that actually I do not need u to be differentiable, right? U can be, it's only like what I need is only that the integral of u exists. So in particular, if this has compact support, and if I know that u was bounded, then this function is always bounded, and so boundedness is enough. So for this, for instance, if I know this definition makes sense for functions u, which are in infinity. Okay. So and this is what I call weak solutions. Now you may ask what is the initial value. Initial value can be incorporated in the weak solution. So I want also this, but now since u is only integrable function, I don't know what is u at zero, right? Because it's zero x is a zero measure set, so I don't know what is u is zero. So if I want to incorporate the initial condition, I have to take more general class of test functions. So if I want to incorporate the initial conditions, I have to take phi, which is the C1 with compact support. But this compact support starts at zero, so which means that phi may not necessarily vanish at zero. Right? I can take a function which has non-zero value at zero. So if I perform the same integration by part, I get one extra term. So let me write down what I get from the first integral.
Plus f of u
dx phi. I get one extra term from integrating here, which actually happens to be minus the integral over r of u 0 x phi 0 x dx, because now phi is not 0 at 0 because of my assumption. It's compact support only in time at capital T, not at 0. So this term will appear, but this should be u 0 x, right? So I replace this by u 0 x. And this is what I call weak solution, which satisfies the initial value. I mean, you can play with the initial value. You can actually show certain continuity of this function. So you can define the initial value also as a kind of weak continuity. I mean, you can show that the function u, which solves this, is weakly continuous in time and so on. But I think this is a more convenient definition. So if you have this for any phi like that, you speak about weak solution which satisfies u at 0, x is equal to u 0. So this is weak solution. So as I say, the advantage of this definition is that you can continue solutions after the time when it becomes discontinuous. I mean, now the shock is not a problem, because before the problem was what happens when the shock appears, like how do I define the derivatives? If I impose this definition, then this problem doesn't occur, because integrability is still okay. We have a Clebec integral, so we don't bother about discontinuity. I mean, it's only okay if the function is Clebec integral, which means measurable boundary function. Okay, so this is a definition that somehow you can continue the problem as a weak solution, and you can speak about weak solutions. Now the question is, do we have, and now we are coming to the crucial point, do we have the entropy inequality also for the weak solutions? Right? So what about the entropy inequality? Because it was useful, for instance, we could use by only integrating this maximum and minimum principle. So now the question is, how about entropy? So can we have this? So what would be the weak formulation of the entropy inequality? Okay, so the original what I have was d by dt of s, where s is the entropy, plus dx of what is called entropy flux. So it should not be the same as s less or equal than zero. Right? This was the original formulation. So now I repeat the same trick. I multiply by some function phi, which is compactly supported. Let's forget the initial data for the time being, but we can do it also for the initial data. So again, let's see 20 times I. And now I want to multiply this by 5, but there is inequality now. So if I want to preserve the inequality, I must take 5, which is greater or equal than 0. Right? I mean, the test function, this phi sometimes is called test function. If I want to preserve inequality, I must take this. So again, now I do it more faster. So I get this phi dt s of u plus phi dx of u. And this is indeed still less or equal than 0. I perform the integration by parts, and I get minus dt phi s of u minus dx phi capital F of u is still less or equal than 0. And now if I want to erase this minus because I don't like it, or maybe it's not a nice word, I can keep it like that, but if I erase this minus, I have to change the inequality. So actually the entropy conditions, in the free formulation is like that for any phi now. Phi should be a function which is C1C 0 t Rn, but in addition must be non-negative. So don't be confused if you see, for instance, in some books the entropy inequality is the opposite sign. This is because you have finally multiplied by minus 1, so you have to change the sign. And so now the question is, if I have this, do I have that? The answer is no. In general, this is not enough. I mean, I give you, of course, the aim of this lecture is not really to study the mathematical theory of Berger's equation, so I just tell you what can be said, but the aim here is to show that in spite of these bad properties of having shocks, we still have compactness for solutions of Berger's equation. So the answer is that this does not imply that. In particular, there are very simple examples which are also shown to students, which we can do, but then we would have a course on hyperbolic conservation laws, is that for this problem is already imposed. So if you consider the class of weak solutions, of course, so you have this class, these are weak solutions, they are of course larger now. You have strong solutions, they are smaller. But we know that if we want like global in time solutions, we cannot stay here. But of course, weak solutions is much larger class. Of course, any strong, not of course, that's something which should be proved, but I think it's not so difficult to see. If I have a strong solution, it is also a weak solution. I just perform this integration by parts. So strong implies weak. Of course, weak does not imply strong. No, it's not. But what is true is that if I have something which is weak plus something which is smooth, if I have weak solution, but I know that the weak solution is smooth, right? So I do not assume I have the equation, but I know a weak solution which is smooth, then you can again reverse the integration. You can get that this implies some strong. You can do it with the equation because that's easy, because if the solution is strong, you put derivatives on these functions back. And so you get this integral identity to be true for any phi, but since it is for any phi, it must be true everywhere because phi is an arbitrary function. And so you have the equation, and then you get the entropy equality because you can perform the multiplication correctly. So weak plus smooth implies strong. Strong implies weak, but weak does not imply strong. And indeed, the class is much larger. So for this problem, there are examples of the initial data which are very elementary. These are initial data of the type. This is sometimes called Riemann problem. We don't have Riemann. We have only groups. Take the initial data, which are very simple. So we have seen that there could be a situation when there is a shock. So I take the initial data, which are like a partial piecewise constant, one constant on the left, one constant on the right, but they are connected by a shock. So this is a very simple initial data, right? And then for this initial data, it can be shown that for this problem, if f of u will be unit segment property. So say f of u is u squared. You can show the existence of infinitely many solutions for this problem. So for the Riemann problem. However, however, if you impose this extra condition, this should be true for any convex S, then you can show that the solution that you satisfy also in the inequality are unique. I mean, that's not easy. I mean, there is a complex theory by Kruskov. It's not my aim here to do Kruskov's theory, but actually, so this means in particular that this does not imply that. So at the level of weak solutions, I'm not allowed to perform this multiplication. However, I can take this as an extra condition. I can say that I have a good solution. Well, here, good is usually called admissible. So I would say admissible solution. I would say I have admissible solution. I have like weak formulation plus the entropy inequality in the weak sense. Now, there is also some kind of confusion between mathematicians and physicists because now I am calling this function entropy, but actually it is energy in the sense of physics. And what people call entropy in the context of so mathematicians like to call it entropy because entropy is something which is convex and all. But for physicists this is energy. And if I go to Euler and I write a compressible Euler and I write down entropy for compressible Euler, it would be minus the NSO. But for us it's entropy is defined in this. And so if I have solution which satisfies also this is admissible solution, and I speak about admissible solution. And so it is a smaller class, and actually in the context of this problem, only of this problem, in the context of Euler, it's largely open whether or not like admissible solutions are limits of Navier's or whatever. But in the context of this very simple problem, you can also show that actually the admissible solution are exactly solutions which are obtained as the viscosity limit. So admissible. Here is equivalent to that the solution is obtained. This is not a serial because the solution is obtained is the zero viscosity limit, which means it's the solution, it's a limit of solution when you wait for plasma on the right hand side. But it's only for this, but it would be a dream to have such a result in fluid mechanics. It would be a dream to say that any solution of Euler is obtained as a limit of Navier Stokes. We don't know. Or at least we know that there are solutions that cannot be. For instance, for compressible Euler, you can show there are weak solutions that are not limits of Navier Stokes. Okay, so now still, how much time I have? 15 minutes, I can still continue maybe. Now my goal still is to convince you that even though we have shocks for this problem, then we still have compactness, provided this is a nonlinear function, for instance, like U squared, which means that we have already seen, even if there were some doubts, that there is a maximum principle for this problem. And you can imagine that if I have admissible solution, I can preserve, I was using for the maximum principle, I was only using the integral of this entropy. And this is true also for the entropy solutions. So actually, I can prove the same for the entropy solutions. So I know that this problem, even in the weak formulation, I have something like maximum principle, which means that if the initial data are bounded, then the solution will remain bounded. So we have solutions in an infinity, even the weak solutions. There are no concentrations. penetrations. We are not facing that phenomena. So we have sort of shown sign in an infinity. So let me repeat again, if I know that U0 is in an infinity, then this implies that the U at D x is also in an infinity, and particularly we have this inequality. Okay, and so we don't have concentrations now. How about oscillations? So this is the last part of this say introduction. So I'm changing the slide now. So I will consider the following situation. Again, what I will show here is a proof of say. I will assume that I have a sequence of strong solutions because I want to simplify. However, everything can be done for the weak solutions. So we know that we have strong solutions, maybe on a short time interval or something like that. Okay, so I assume that I have this entropy formulation, which means that I have the entropy inequality, which you may think is satisfied also for the weak solutions, for the admissible weak solution in this integral sense. And I will assume that I have a sequence which is bounded by some constant. I will assume that I have sequence of solutions of my problem, which is bounded by some constant C, which is independent, it's uniform in D and X, and it's independent of M. Right? So I sort of, and you see that this is a realistic assumption, because if I take U0, which is bounded, then U will be bounded at any time, so this property will be preserved. So I can somehow, you know, you can make any assumption you like, but they must be realistic in the sense that your problem should admit this kind of estimates. And we have seen that we have the maximum principle. So this is something which is legal to assume. And now I assume that I have, so what kind of convergence I can, but I don't have anything else, right? I don't have any other information on UN. I only know that it is a solution of my problem. Now you may say, so can I say, I would like to say, for instance, that UN converges to some limit, maybe almost everywhere. If I have this, I could, for instance, think about the weak formulation. So I have the weak formulation, which is something like U dt phi f of UN dx phi. So assume that I have a sequence of weak solutions. If I can show almost everywhere convergence, this will converge almost everywhere to U. And since this converges almost everywhere, f of UN will converge to f of U. So I would, the conclusion would be that the limit is again a weak solution of the same problem. We have seen that if I have only weak convergence, it is not true, right? Because we know that if this converges only weakly to some limit, then I can pass to the limit here. But if I pass to the limit here, I showed you examples that the weak limit is something what I will denote in the future f of u bar, but it's not necessarily f of u. And so we do not have the property that we have a sequence of so the set of solutions is not compact in the weak topologies of the speed. You can get out of the set of solutions. And so I will try to convince you that in the case of this very special equation, this is not true. So this is amazing because I'm not going to assume anything about the initial data, that they are compound, whatever. I just assume that I have this bound and I have solutions. And I show you that the only fact that solutions do satisfy these equations, even in the weak sense, implies that the sequence must be compact. So this is a kind of example of compactness which is imposed by the nonlinear problem. It's very, very amazing that nonlinearity can impose some kind of compactness. The fact that I'm solving nonlinear problem is so strong that solution cannot oscillate. So there is no oscillation. This problem does not admit oscillation. It's a good problem. Okay, so this is a long way, but I will start today and I will continue to one of the no oscillations. Okay, so no oscillations. So what I can assume? So I can assume that I have this, right? So I can assume, since I assume that this is bounded, I can assume that UN converges. Okay, I did not introduce these topologies, but I think we simply don't really have time. So what it means, weakly star in an infinity, why I am writing in this way? This means nothing other than this, that u n converges, u n phi converges to u phi. For any phi, like in my definition when I was thinking, plus u n is bounded in the infinity space, which means it's uniformly bounded everywhere by some constant. That's what I want. So I have this boundedness. So the statement is, okay, it's a mathematical statement, but it's not. There's no time to do everything. If I have a sequence which is bounded, then I can have a subsequence such that the subsequence converges weakly, which means that the integral averages of this subsequence will converge to the integral average of some function. That's functional analysis. So since I have this bound, I can assume that. I can assume that S is the entropy, converges weakly to something, but I don't know if it's S of U, right? Because S in general is a nonlinear function, and I have only V convergence of U, so this limit exists. Again, this is up to a subsequence, I should say subsequence, every single subsequence. So this limit exists, but I denote it by S U bar because I don't know if it's F of U. And F of U n converges to some F of U bar, again in this space, because everything is bounded. And this is for any convex S and for any convex and for any corresponding flat S. So this is what I can assume up to a subsequence. This follows from that. And now I claim that this actually really implies non-convergence. So for that, I'm changing the slide now, hoping that I will see. Yes. So I'm changing the slide. And so for that, for showing that, I use a tool which is very beautiful. And I think I will have time to sketch the proof, or at least to explain the result. This is the so-called Difker lemma. And this is a tool which was, so Difker lemma goes back to Richter Tarr and François Murat. And so we will use this lemma for proving compactness result, right? So this will be a tool. So a priori, this does not have anything to do with the equations, but later on I will show you how to apply this result. So what this result tells you? So this is the most general form. I will show you some sketch of the proof because it looks like it is a very deep result actually. But I think the Tartar, he was a genius in the sense that he could somehow use very simple things in a very, ingenious way. So the proof of this is, if you think about it, it looks like complicated, but it's very simple. So what it tells you? It tells you that you have two sequences of functions, un and vn, and they are vector values, so these are vectors, and they converge weakly. If you want, you can forget this LP and Q. They converge weakly in the sense of averages, which means they can oscillate in particular, right? You allow them to oscillate. Now, so we know now that you would like to show that un and vn, if you take the scalar product, if you think about scalar functions, you take like un times vn, right? Now you take the scalar product. And you would like to show that the scalar product, which is a nonlinear function of these two quantities, converges to the scalar product of the weak limit. This is not in general true, right? I mean, there is a simple example. Think about un. If I assume only this, that's true. So think about the case that un is equal to vn, right? Then the scalar product is just un squared. And what you want to show is that un squared converges weakly to u squared. But we know that this is not possible if you have only v convergence. We need strong convergence for that. And so this is not true in general. So the Tartar adds some conditions. And this is why this is called compensated compactness. So for instance, if we knew that gradient of un and gradient of vn were bounded in some space L2, then we would have compactness from Lerich-Kondrasche's theorem, because we know that if the gradient is bounded, then the function itself is compact. But we do not know that. But his claim was, in order to prove convergence of the scalar product, we can allow the functions to oscillate, but they must not oscillate in the same direction. So we have seen this very simple example of scalar conservation law, linear conservation law. This function dt of u plus dx of u is equal to zero, where we have seen that the solution can oscillate, but only in certain direction. Right? The oscillation propagated, but it could be only in this direction, not in the perpendicular direction. In the perpendicular direction, the solution is constant. It does not oscillate. And so Tartar's observation was that actually if these two guys do oscillate, but in a perpendicular direction, you don't see this in the scalar product, and so the limit is true. And so in perpendicular direction, means that you impose some kind of conditions like that. This doesn't tell you that gradient of u is bounded. It just tells you that certain linear combination of derivatives of u is bounded. That's exactly what are these two assumptions. The first assumption is that the divergence u, well, he says the divergence u precompact, so this is really the most general form. But let's say in the simplest case, I mean the original version of the Dicker lemma is done in the case when actually divergence of u, what is divergence of u n? This is, so these are general vector valued functions. So this is dx1 of u1 plus dx2 of u2 plus dxn un. And the original formulation was that this is equal to 0. You can extend it to the case that this is a precompact function. Again, forget this for a moment. Right? Assume that this is 0. 0 is definitely precompact in anything you want. You may wonder what is divergence if I don't say anything about derivatives. The divergence is defined exactly in the weak sense, right? So you put derivatives on the test functions, and you assume that the new quantity you get is 0. Okay. Let's start with this case. And now curl, what is rotation? Okay, rotation of V is defined as the anti-symmetric matrix. Okay, so this is a matrix dxi vj minus dxj vi. So, I mean, that's the definition which I like. Sometimes if you are in the three-dimensional space, rotation is curl, is just curl. Curl is the curl operator, which somehow coincides with this. And so in particular, I will also assume in my proof that I know that this curl Vn is actually equal to 0. And so we know that this implies, there is a theorem, which implies that actually if the curl of Vn is 0, then this Vn itself can be written as a gradient of some function, of a gradient of some scalar field, which I denote phi n. Okay, so let me show you. I can do it in 2 minutes, so it looks like. And then the rest of the proof is, maybe you can use, you have to use some sophisticated tools of functional analysis, but everything is like straightforward. I mean, once you can see it, for the case when there is zero, you can do everything. So how do you do it in the case of zero? So I assume this, and what I want to prove is the following. So I assume that I have un, now I have un, such that the divergence of un is equal to 0, and I have vn, such that the curl of vn is equal to 0, which means that vn can be written as a gradient of some property of phi. You know, this means these are like differential equations, right? So these conditions means that un satisfies certain equation, like here there was transport. Here, this is a certain differential equation. This is a certain linear differential equation. So you do have some sequences that, in addition, satisfy some sequence or some set of equations. Right? So this is some extra information. And, of course, this does not imply compactness of these sequences. But it implies compactness of the product. Why? Because, this Vn is something which is bounded, so it's a bounded sequence in LQ. Well, let's take P equal to Q to be equal to 2. Right, so this is bounded, say, in L2. Again, later on, everything can be generalized. Well, if Vn is bounded in L2, which means that the gradient of phi n is bounded in L2, so phi n itself is compact, because we have this really compact Lachev theorem, so phi n, the potential itself, is bounded in W12, which means some whole space of functions which have derivative in L2. So phi n, actually, you can show that it converges almost everywhere to 5, like 5 hand converges through it. And now what you want to show is the following. You want to show that Vn, okay, the product is um multiplied by some function phi, when you integrate, there is no divide and other, that this converges to V, U, phi, divide for any phi, which is smooth compact support. Right, this is what this is meant by V conversion. This is V conversion. Not exactly that. This is what we have to show. Okay, so now it's very simple because now I write it in the following way. So I know that this Vn is this Vn is a gradient of phi n. So instead of Vn, I write the gradient of phi n. And U n phi. And this is equal to that. Now I do integration by parts. If I do integration by parts, I have to put the gradient on this product. This is a vector-valued function, so this gives me minus phi n. If I put the gradient on the product, I get two terms. I get the first term will be divergence of un phi minus phi n un gradient of phi. So I have these two terms. But divergence of un is zero, so this term is not there, which is good because I do not control this term. I have only this, but now phi n converges strongly almost everywhere, and un converges weakly. It can be shown again, I don't have time to prove everything, but if we have one sequence which converges strongly and one weakly, the product converges to the right. So this converges indeed to minus phi u gradient of phi, but now this minus phi is minus gradient of phi. So actually, now I can do the same, I can go back and I get the divergence of u, which is zero because it's a limit of divergence free function. So finally I get gradient of phi u phi capital phi, and this is the result to be. That's the whole problem. Elementary two lines. But it's incredibly strong statement which we will use tomorrow for showing compactness of solutions for scalar conservation law. So, okay, so of course I have to open many things here, but again I'm not going, of course there is many subtle things related to the fact that we have exponents and we don't have zero and so on, but this is the elementary idea behind the proof. So let's take it as a tool, but the proof is basically there. Okay, so tomorrow I will continue applying this compensated compactness results to the scalar conservation law and showing you that solutions are compact. So don't be disappointed because I promised to speak about convex integration. I'm speaking about the compensated compactness, which I said is the opposite. But I want somehow at the beginning to make this contrast between this theory and what we do later, right? So you will see that here we are very lucky. Solutions are compact. Everything is fine, but this property will be exactly violated for the Euler system. So that's exactly what we will not have for Euler. Yeah. Okay, so I think I stop here now because it's time for lunch. And maybe also questions.